What's new in WCAG 2.2? Presented by Sarah Pulis, A11y Bytes 2021. Hello everyone and happy Global Accessibility Awareness Day. My name is Sarah Pulis. I actually wear two hats. I'm both director and co-founder at Intopia, but also I am founder of A11y Bytes. Now, I don't normally do A11y Bytes presentations, but for anyone who knows me, you know that I'm a pretty big fan of WCAG and I really love getting into the detail. So I thought I would come and share what we're seeing in the new WCAG 2.2 working draft. If you would like to catch me on Twitter, my Twitter handle is SarahTP. WCAG, or the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines, is the most referenced accessibility standard across the world. It tells us how to make our digital content more accessible for people with disability. WCAG 2.0 was published in June 2010. 10 years later, WCAG 2.1 was published in June of 2018. WCAG 2.2 is currently a working draft, due to be published in September this year. As a working draft, there still will be some changes. So what we're sharing today is the current state of WCAG 2.2. When it's released, make sure to check for changes and updates to the new requirements. So what is new in the WCAG 2.2 working draft? First of all success criteria from 2.0 and 2.1 are included in 2.2. Each of these criteria are exactly the same, word for word. One change, however, is that an existing criteria, 2.4.7, focus visible, has changed from a level AA in WCAG 2.1 to a level A in 2.2. So essentially, it has been promoted. In addition to this, there are 9 new success criteria proposed, 4 at level A, 4 at level AA, and 1 at AAA. Let's do a quick run through of the 9 new proposed success criteria in 9 minutes. All right, let's start by looking at the 4 level A criteria. Our first criterion is 3.2.6, consistent help. In plain language, this requirement asks that when information about customer support channels is available in your product, whether that be a website or an app, that you include that information in the same location and using the same language across your product. Support channels could include a way to contact a human directly, like a phone number or email address, a mechanism to contact a human where they can get back to you, like a contact form or social media, self-help options, like frequently asked questions, or automated contact, like a chatbot. Now, the criterion doesn't actually say you have to provide support channels, but this is definitely in a best practice list for me. Providing different channels that suit the different needs and preferences of those trying to contact you will give them choice. When a user is able to quickly find the help they need, they are able to complete the task even if they're encountering challenges for whatever reason. Our next criterion is 3.3.7, accessible authentication. In plain language, this requires you to provide at least one authentication method that does not require a person to remember, manipulate, or transcribe information. Or if you do include an authentication method that does require someone to either remember, manipulate, or transcribe information, that you provide a way to help that person complete the authentication method themselves. The intent of this requirement is to provide an accessible, easy to use and secure method to log in and access content. People with difficulty with memory, reading, numbers, or perception processing limitations may have difficulty with certain authentication methods. For example, people may have difficulty with remembering information, such as a username or password, transcribing information, such as a one-time passcode sent to your phone, or solving puzzles like captures. Now, copy and paste can be relied upon to avoid transcription. So someone may save their password in a password manager. Just don't disable the copy and paste function. On to 3.3.8, redundant entry. So when a person is completing a task, Make sure information that has been previously entered or provided is auto-filled or available for someone to reuse. The intent of this criteria is to reduce cognitive effort when someone has to enter the same information in more than one step during a process. When you ask people to remember information that is required for any sort of input, it can be a significant barrier to users with cognitive or memory difficulties. We can all experience mental fatigue from a long process, which is made worse by the stress of recalling information from short-term working memory. Help users complete a process as easily as possible by reducing that mental fatigue. Our last level A criterion is 2.4.13, page break navigation. In essence, this requirement asks that when web pages are broken up into a series of pages, think multiple pages with page numbers, people can consistently find and reference content even when the content is adapted. This means that whether the content changes, maybe you increase text size or the like, those numbers remain the same. Although the criterion itself doesn't reference printed material, one of the best practice recommendations is that for page locations to match across both digital and print materials. So people are still able to find their place and find references to content based on consistent page numbers that are the same whether you're looking at a print version, a default version, or a version where you have changed something like the text size. All right, on to our four AA criteria. Our next one is 2.5.7 dragging movements. In plain language, this requires features that use a dragging motion, like drag and drop or sliders, can also be performed using a single pointer gesture without the need to drag. So a single pointer gesture is something like a single or double tap or mouse press. This new requirement makes sure that people who cannot perform a dragging motion, whether due to limited dexterity or the input device that they're using, to still be able to do everything they need to do. It doesn't mean you can't use the dragging feature, just that there needs to be an alternative that everyone can perform. Next up, 3.2.7, visible controls. So in this requirement, we're being asked that when a person is doing a task, at least one instance of each control necessary to complete the task must be visible without the need to hover or to focus on an element. So hidden controls may be difficult for people to find, including those with cognitive disability, low vision, and mobility and motor impairment. Our biggest culprit here is when controls are hidden until, say, you hover over them or you, as a keyboard user, tab to them. Even if a user discovers a hidden control, they might not remember how to show and operate that control the next time they come to your site. So short answer, don't hide controls. Make them visible and persistent on the screen at all times. So I was pretty sad when target size in WCAG 2.1 was only a AAA requirement. But in 2.2, we've got a new proposed criteria, 2.5.8, target size minimum. So this requirement suggests that touch targets that are at least 24 CSS pixels in size, or that the target size plus spacing is at least 24 CSS pixels, except when the targets are in a sentence or block of text, like a link in a paragraph. Interestingly, if you read, you know, your Google or Apple guidelines, they still recommend a touch target size of 44 CSS pixels or larger, which is actually in line with the AAA touch size requirement. So what do I say? Go big or go home. Our last AA requirement is 2.4.11, focus appearance minimum. The intent of this criteria is to make sure that our keyboard focus indicators are clearly visible and discernible. Now, whereas our focus visible criteria requires that we have a visible focus indicator, this new proposed criteria defines a minimum level of visibility. Now, there's a lot that goes into this criteria. But in summary, we want good contrast between the focused and unfocused states, as well as with adjacent colours. And there's also a minimum size requirement for the contrasting area. Our 1AAA requirement is 2.4.12 Focus Appearance Enhanced. So we just heard about Focus Appearance Minimum, which is a AA requirement. A AAA requirement has more rigorous requirements for better visibility. So that's going to result in a more highly visible focus indicator. In short, we've got a higher contrast ratio for our contrasting area, as well as expanding the minimum size requirements for that contrasting area as well. So what are the timelines for WCAG 2.2, which have been shared by the Web Accessibility Initiative? We currently are on our second working draft. That's what this presentation is based on. They expect by June, we will be in candidate recommendation stage. By August, it will move to proposed recommendation. And then hopefully in September, we will have that final published recommendation. But stay tuned for updates on the Web Accessibility Initiative website. Thank you all so much for listening. If you'd like to get in contact with me, you can tweet me at SarahTP or email me at sarah@intopia.digital. Happy GAD! A11y Bytes 2021.